everybody. Welcome to the weekly show. I'm T.
And I'm A.
You know what? You know who's one of my favorite rappers?
Don't say Kanye West.
Kanye West. And I heard, you know, something happened with him in SNL.
Yeah, actually. A few weeks ago, he performed. God bless Kanye West. Bless his soul. He performed, and apparently SNL took his Life of Pablo album without asking. So basically, Kanye West went off on a rant saying that he's the greatest, you know, he's more influential than this person, than MJ, you know. He did his Kanye West thing.
Mm. And I also heard that the guy who is the lead for Deadpool.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Ryan Reynolds, a.k.a. Deadpool, he actually did a parody of it. And it's on our Facebook page.
So check it out when you get a chance. But I kind of understand where Kanye West is coming from.
I don't.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
But anyway. I kind of understand where he's coming from a little bit, where it comes from. You plan for something to happen, and it doesn't happen.
Mm.
You know, without even your intel. You know, so my question is for you. Have you ever planned for something to happen, and it doesn't happen?
Yeah, well, you know. I once planned to have tea in this cup.
Well, honey, drink it all.
I'm telling my story. I once planned to have tea in this cup. I drank all the tea. I didn't plan for me to drink all the tea. I thought I would have me some tea. You know? So that's my story. What about you? You ever plan for anything to happen? Actually, yes, you have. You plan to drink the tea, and then I drink it. See that? Go ahead, tell me your story.
Cut the camera off. He about to get beat.
Don't you play. Go ahead.
Give me my tea. Anyway, sorry about that. Yes, I actually did have to plan something, and it actually didn't go my way. I was actually with a dance company a while back.
Really?
Yeah, when I was younger, and they actually put me in the head of it, being the president. The people in the group didn't really like me that much because of how great I was doing, I guess. And they just started taking the meetings in their own hands and just started planning things without me. So yeah. I guess you could say things did go haywire. Let's just say I'm not with that group anymore.
Let's just say you're not.
Yeah.
So anyway, I heard that you bought a book for us.
Yes. Anybody that really knows me knows that I love me a good book.
Yes.
And this book called Whiskey Words and a Shovel, written by R.H. Sin, was recommended to me by a good friend of mine. You know who you are. And this book is filled with so many quotes about friendship, heartbreak, how to move on from heartbreak. It's like its own art form. You know, how I see an art form isn't going to be the same way you see it.
Yeah.
You know, from page to page, it's like its own story. And I recommend this book for anybody that wants to read it, for mature audiences only.
Well, I hear you about a quote. Read us your quote.
Yes. The name of the piece is called Wanting. I guess what we want is someone who only wants us. Sounds simple, doesn't it? Yet some set out to find this and die trying. Not the death, which means the ending of life in the literal sense, but the burial of one's heart as they decide that love isn't for them.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really nice.
I drink your tea again. But that's bullcrap. Love is for everybody. There's 7 billion people in this world. You can find someone.
And yet you have none. But yeah, just calling it like I see it. But hey, it's a
give me your tea.
But
that was mean.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Don't touch me.
Okay.
You know what? You know what? Now that we're starting out everyone's dirty laundry.
Tell us
about your thoughts on love. How about that?
You know, I think for anybody to have love, you have to have it with yourself first before you give it to someone
else. So you must love yourself.
I do. Yeah. And I love someone. I love you too.
Don't touch me.
No.
Don't touch me.
But you got my cup.
Anyway, let's move on to relationships. Oh, God.
See, the devil met you at the door. Anyway, so, our special topic for the day is relationships. Personally, I think relationships are a very beautiful thing. You know, I mean, when you are honest with someone, you really care for somebody, and it's between you two and you two only, not the people on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, something that's for only you two.
So you don't like PSA?
I don't say I don't like PSA, but I mean, I don't mind sharing a couple pictures on social media. But
yeah.
I'm not going to put my business out there like, ooh, I did this with this person and blah, blah, blah.
I think sharing pictures are okay on Instagram, Twitter, but not on Facebook, you know? You friend your family on Facebook.
Mm.
You can't share everything. Okay, so let's say I was dating someone and I shared a picture of us kissing in front of the Eiffel Tower.
Us?
Not.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. Are you guarding
traffic? Say that I shared a photo of me and my significant other kissing in front of the Eiffel Tower. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother responded something with like, He's 21 years. 21 years later, he still got finally got somebody.
Oh, you gonna give grandma some B baby? Oh.
No. Okay. You see, family, they get involved on Facebook. You leave Facebook for family. That's why the F is there. It's Face Family Book.
That's true.
Instagram and Twitter is for everyone else.
Okay, true. But what I'm trying to say is, like, we've lost communication in relationships because communication has changed over the years.
Yeah.
And went from this to actually texting that.
Excuse me 1 second. Got a text message. But yeah, I totally get what you're saying about the whole communication thing.
Yeah, exactly. And hopefully one day that'll change because communication is always changing.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, I mean, I would challenge, you know, my significant other if I had one. Yeah. To, like, just not talk to me through text. Like, just pick up the phone and call me sometime.
I mean, but calling, it doesn't take a lot to call someone. Yeah. But you gotta know how to talk to someone.
Yeah, or maybe, like, when we're out to eat, like, don't look at your phone for a while. Like, turn it off. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, challenge yourself to do something.
Wow, you should practice what you preach, you know?
You know, you were just on the phone 5 minutes ago.
I got a text from a very important person. Call. And it was not my
phone. Here's his number. Okay? You want to be texting Jesus, that's his number.
Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. You better tell him what you want.
You know, that's right. But anyway, that concludes Tea Time. We'll see y'all next time. Hello, everybody. Welcome to In the Spotlight.
Today, we're in downtown Baltimore, where we're going to explore and have some fun and get into some new adventures.
While also exploring the little joys of Baltimore, so stay tuned.
So our first stop downtown is right here in front of the Coast Guard boat. Tell us about this boat.
It's a boat on water.
Ah.
Right here on our show, we love to encourage our readers to read more. So one of my favorite spots in Baltimore is the Barnes & Noble store.
I like it.
Do you read?
Sometimes.
I mean a physical book.
You know what? Look. Can we just go inside?
Alright, let's go. So here we are in Barnes & Noble. A long time ago, this place was a warehouse in the early 1900s, but as time went on, it slowly started to become a bookstore.
Finished up here in Barnes & Noble, now on to the next spot.
Follow us.
Find the aquarium. It's a perfect place to come and check out some fish. You know, if you want to swim with the fishes, you can always dive with them or dive in the harbor.
In the harbor?
In the harbor. All right, on to the next spot.
It's still out of all the wonderful things that downtown Baltimore is historically known for, such as restaurants, stores, and beautiful landscapes, there's a piece of it that not only has a place in the hearts of American society, but it holds a place in the heart of the Inner Harbor, which is memorabilia from one of the Twin Towers from the 9/11 attacks. Every time that Eris and I come downtown, we always make sure that we pay homage to those who have gone before us on this tragic day. If you come across this piece on your travels to Baltimore, there's a huge marble plaque that has the names of the people who were from Maryland that died in the attack. And on the far right, it has a timeline of the events that occurred on that fateful day. When I look at this plaque of all the names and see a piece from one of the towers, it reminds me that the world we live in can be a better place with love, patience, and understanding. And when we obtain more peace within our homeland, we can then share it with the rest of the world. So, one of our favorite spots to have peace and quiet is Federal Hill, which is our last stop for the day.
Your style, your smile, your peace mentality. Lord, have mercy on me. I was blind, now I can see. What I came supposed to be. Baby, I feel free. Come on and go with me. Let's take a long walk around the park after dark. Find a spot, us to spark. Conversation, verbal elation, stimulation, share our situation, temptation, education, relax. fixation, elevation. Maybe we can talk about Sora 3118.
Welcome to Backstage, the segment where we go around to your local theaters and we pretty much dive head first into the theater process. On this segment, you'll see interviews from actors, directors, and some technical majors.
So calling all thespians, come on backstage with CCBC Catonsville.
Hello everybody, I'm here with my good friend SJ, who has been stage managing at CCBC for about a couple years now, am I right?
Yeah.
And I'm going to be asking her a few questions about the theater world, the theater life, and what it is that she loves about the theater. So, SJ, how long have you been at CCBC?
I've been at CCBC for about 2 years now.
Have you been enjoying it?
For the most part, yes.
That's great. Okay.
My first semester, not so much, because my first semester I wasn't doing theater, and so I was pretty lonely, but then I found the theater program here, and I was immersed in the world of theater, and it's such a great theater community here, and I fell in love with it, and it really became my second home.
Right. Well, here's the thing. Now, I know you're not necessarily an actress, but you're mostly a technical theater person, so how did you come in terms with that?
Well, I've always really liked to build things, and I'm better at building and sculpting and creating than I am at drawing. Mm. And I personally don't like acting with the few experiences that I have had when I was younger. Mm. It just, acting wasn't my thing. And I don't have the concentration and the patience to sit for a long period of time. So getting up and building and doing things, and it was my calling.
How long have you been doing technical theater?
I've been doing technical theater since my sophomore year of high school, so it's been about 4.5 years now.
Oh, that's good. What productions have you been working on?
Well, besides the productions here at CCBC, I've worked on 4 high school shows, Man of La Mancha, Of Mice and Men, Rumors, and Bye Bye Birdie. Mm. And over the summer last year, I did a production in Westminster for a theater company called the Theater Without Limits. It's a nonprofit organization that raises money for one of the schools out there, and we did Steel Magnolias.
So what do you love about the theater?
Well, theater is just one big happy family, but not everyone is happy. There's always drama in the drama department.
Oh yeah.
But I mean, I really like it because despite the fact that it is chaos, it's organized chaos. So despite the fact that everything is touch and go and we wing half the things we do.
Right, it is a family. You know, it's not always easy, but it's worth it at the end of the day. You wear a lot of many hats in the theater company here at CCBC. You're a stage manager, plus you work with Mo with technical theater.
Yes.
So what is the hardest thing with both? How to balance both?
Well, to be a stage manager, you have to balance everything, because if you don't do a good job as a stage manager, your show's not going to go well.
Mm-hmm.
So during the show, I'm literally on the headset, on the walkie-talkie, like, flies, go, lights, go, sound, go.
Yeah.
So working with Mo, who designs and creates everything here, has really helped me understand and appreciate everything else.
What do you suggest for anybody that wants to become a stage manager or has been put into the job or the role of being a stage manager? What do you suggest for them as far as tips, what to do beforehand, after?
Sticky notes. Lots of sticky notes. Seriously, they're lifesavers. Because I stick them in my little book and mark different places and actors and people, and I love my sticky notes. Mm. And they make the world go round. Sticky notes.
So, whose work do you admire most theater-wise?
Definitely Mo Khan, who is the theater director here at Catonsville.
Very talented man, by the way.
Oh, he's not the theater director. He's the
technical
theater director.
What is it about his work that you like?
He's so very mellow about his work. He's just a mellow person overall, and it really shows in his work, because even though this is a very high-stress environment, he can, at the last minute, create something beautiful. And it's amazing.
Yeah, it is. his last show that he worked on, Intimate Apparel. He did a good job. I mean, he does a good job on all his shows, but MAGA, he did that. But is technical theater a long-term career choice that you want to do in the future?
Yes, definitely.
What are your plans after CCBC?
I would like to go overseas and work in the theater, be a stage manager in the theater overseas. Cool. I just said the same thing twice.
It's all good. But, well, that's it for with me and SJ. Thank you all for tuning in. And thank you, SJ.
Today we're here with Zach Hartley, one of the professors at CCBC Catonsville. Hi, Zach. Thanks for being on the show.
Hi, Iris. My pleasure.
We're going to ask you a couple questions. I'm going to ask you a couple questions. So my first question is, how long have you been at CCBC Theater?
Oh boy, less than a year. I really just started here. This is my second semester.
Okay. So how long have you been acting?
Since I was a kid, I think. I was in my first play when I was in second grade. I played the cool Christmas elf who didn't want to build toys because he wanted to go to a concert. And then I saw Camelot with Robert Goulet and it made me want to be an actor. So I've been acting now, let's say illegitimately for 25 years and legitimately for 15 or 16.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
So how many productions do you think you've worked on?
80 to 100, somewhere in that range.
That's a lot of production.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you love about theater?
I love the process. I'm a process junkie. I like seeing things come together. I like seeing people make discoveries about how they feel about things. I think in real life, people push their feelings down way more. I don't know. I don't want to say way more than they should, but they just do it a lot, whether it's for necessity or because of a personality trait. But the theater is a safe space to feel. And I've never met a person who felt something on stage that didn't feel good about it.
Okay. I get you that feeling. You like those feelings. So whose work do you admire, theater-wise?
Anne Bogart. She is probably my favorite theater artist. My former teachers, Janine Thompson, Terry Kent at Kent State University is wonderful. But artists that people might really know, I think James Earl Jones is probably the best stage actor I've ever seen. Anne Bogart. I'll just stick with Anne Bogart.
So what shows are you working on right now?
I'm working on Rashomon here at CCBC.
I'm in that show.
He is in that show.
Can you tell us a bit about it?
I can. It's originally a short story that was turned into a film by Akira Kurosawa, who, if you don't know, is the inspiration behind movies like The Magnificent Seven, a lot of American westerns. He wrote The Seven Samurai, which was translated into The Magnificent Seven. So, and lots of his other movies have been translated into American westerns. But Rashomon is a story about memory. It's an event that happens in the woods, and there are four responses to that event, different ways that people remember. And in Rashomon, everyone is the hero of their own story. So you get people who, for instance, a woman in the play who insists that she is the perfect wife in her memories. A bandit in the play who insists that he is a heroic, powerful, legendary warrior. A samurai who is nothing but honorable. And a woodsman who, though honest, has his own necessities that he needs to cover. I think it's really important to talk about this kind of stuff right now. We have events happening all the time. And immediately after the event, somebody gives a point of view that is opposite of somebody else's point of view of what happened there. So I think it's an important story and an important idea to remember that we don't remember things exactly as they happened.
That's true. Well, that's pretty much our interview. You can check out more of Rashomon when it opens in April at CCBC Catonsville.
Now we're here with Tyrell, who is an actor here at CCBC Catonsville. We're going to ask him a couple questions. So our first question for you, Tyrell, is how long have you been at CCBC Theater?
I've been at CCBC Theater for about 2 years.
Hmm. 2 years.
How many productions have you been in so far?
Actually, this will be my first production.
Wow, what's the name of it?
It's going to be Rashomon. It's going to be directed by Zach Hartley.
We just spoke with him.
Well, he seems like a cool guy.
Yeah.
So what productions have you seen at CCBC?
I have seen Intimate Apparel, and I have also seen Neighborhood 3.
As an actor, we all have our own stories of why we fall in love with the theater. Why do you fall in love with the theater? What's special about it?
I like the theater because it's more along of having an atmosphere of acceptance. Mm. Like, you can be on the stage and you will not be criticized as to what you're doing. It's the only place where you can be truly free and not be, you know, a part of the herd, if that makes sense. Because when I get on stage, I feel as though that it doesn't matter what your background is or, you know, what kind of past you had, so to speak. It's more along the lines of what's going on right now. Yeah. What, like, how does this make you feel as an actor? And, like, how can you show the people a good time on stage? Whether it's crying, having fun, telling jokes, being in a comedy, or, like, a vengeful scene. Yeah. It's just all about how far you... It's all about, I want to say, like I said before, acceptance. Like, nobody will criticize you as long as you're able to commit to your part.
Mm. Is acting your long-term goal?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
What plans do you have after CCBC?
CCBC, I actually just want to do as many auditions as possible. And I have high hopes of trying to get into NYU. Their GPA is a 4.0 average, and I'm trying to keep that 4.0 average going.
We hear you. I understand. What lifetime goals has the theater taught you as an actor and as a person? Is it teamwork? Is it, you know,
it's
time
actually,
management?
It's teamwork, time management, most definitely. You have to actually, like, sit back and memorize your lines. But it's more along the lines of knowing where you stand at as a person. Because before I actually decided to become an actor, I just thought, you know, I was okay as I was. But actually, when you really sit back and take classes on how to become an actor,
yeah,
you start to realize where you stand at in life, like your weaknesses, your strengths, like... Comedy for me will probably be something really I can get behind. Mm-hmm. Whereas though being serious or like in a, I guess, intense scene will be my weakness. So acting actually improves you as a person as a whole.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Do you have any fears regarding, you know, theater? You said it's your lifetime long-term goal to become an actor. Do you have any fears?
Being a terrible actor.
Just sucking? Yeah, I'm afraid of that too. Whose work do you mind, like, theater-wise?
Honestly, I have to throw back to Zach Hartley. Because his is more like, I want to say Zach's technique is more on the lines of you figuring out yourself. And then it's more like hands-on instead of just sitting back and just, you know, flip through the pages, memorizing the lines. Like, you have to get emotion and get in touch with who the character is and how can you become that character.
Right.
If that makes sense.
Do you have any more questions?
No, that's all the time we have today. Thank you, Tyrell, for spending time with us, and we'll see y'all next time.
This has been The Weekly Show.
I'm T.
And I'm A. Tonight we covered...
relationships on Tea Time.
We went downtown and saw some interesting spots.
And most importantly, we went backstage with CCBC Catonsville. Hello, actors.
So that's pretty much our show. Join us next week.
On The Weekly Show. I'm T.
And I'm A. Bye.